You guys sit down. Sit down over there. We're all very excited from Naples to represent here. I'm honored to be a speaker. For many years, I came. The first one was in 2009, the Kingdom Training Seminar. And I sat here like a sponge. You guys know that cartoon SpongeBob SquarePants? Well, I'm Trista Sue SquarePants SpongeBob. That's my name. Like a sponge. And so it's an honor to also teach what I have learned. I have sat here and learned the principles, and then I go home and apply them. And there's a big difference. Because you can sit here and hear and take notes, but what you do when you leave these doors, that's completely up to you. You have to apply the knowledge, and that's wisdom. So I pray, that is my prayer for you today, that you can glean from my practical tips and go home and influence. That's my goal. Now, Dr. Myles heard my story a little bit earlier this year about where I came from, because most people know, okay, she owns a hotel, her family must have money, they have many businesses. She grew up with a silver spoon in her mouth. Well, I did not. I grew up with a shovel in my hand. And when I was born, we lived in a shack, and it was so bad it was condemned by the city. So we moved on up into the trailer park. And so now, don't feel bad for me, because we were the only trailer that had a double wide. So it wasn't single, weren't 20 foot wide. We were a 40 foot wide trailer. And we did have a pool. My daddy built us a pool there. So the Lord has given me management over this resource. And for the past 20 years, he's seen what I can do with this block of concrete. And adding value and managing and utilizing kingdom principles with the resources and the people that he's entrusted me with. And so I wanted to show you also a few pictures here. I went to visit my father a few months ago, he lives 30 miles from me, and he's a water well driller. So I'm a water well driller's daughter. My daddy's passion and purpose in life has to do with water, and my job is to dispense it. Just like my father, he gives you living water. So I do the same that he does. And this is a derrick rig. And so when I was rebellious as a teenager, I would sneak it at night and dare the boys to climb it with me. I'd be like, come on, boys, who wants to climb the rig? It's 120 foot high. So that's the kind of fun that I had growing up around all this equipment. Now, our mandate, as we know, our signature scripture is Genesis 1:26. We were created in the image of God, and our mandate is to influence and rule the earth with his nature. Now, we understand this. Now, this should be a natural process for you as a kingdom citizen, because Father God naturally is an influencer. His presence brings influence, the culture. It's natural. So my goal is for you to understand, you don't have to toil, you don't have to sweat, you don't have to try to figure out how do I influence. It's a natural process. And every God-given gift that he has deposited in each of you will do this naturally. Number one, I cannot stress this enough. The number one key to being an influencer is to be genuine. Just being yourself. You don't have to impress anybody. You don't have to wear the power tie to be an influencer. Ladies, you don't even have to wear the heels to be an influencer. Just be genuine. Now, this includes having no ulterior motives whatsoever. And I love that Dr. Myles finished talking about this. How many people come up to you, and when they meet you, how can I benefit from you? They're thinking that. What can I get out of this relationship with you? What can she offer me? How can I benefit? And I'm like, man, that's not how you feel. Listen, the world knows. They see if you have ulterior motives. They know that. They're not stupid. They see you coming a mile away. So listen. Just drop the charades, just be yourself, and just be their friends. That's all. Now listen, the wealthy people in Naples that we deal with, they're not used to people just being their friend, just to be their friend. They're used to, I know you want something from me. My influence, my connections, my checkbook, something. So if you're really genuine, you'll stand out. They're like, man, they're not playing games. Listen, people know when you're playing games. So don't play games. Everyone's doing it. This is one of my favorite men in the Bible. When Jesus saw Nathanael, he said, now here is an Israelite where there's no deceit. That's what I want God to say about me. When people see me, man, there's Trista. She has no ulterior motives. She don't want nothing from me. That's just Trista, just being herself. That's the highest compliment. So to me, this is a great man. The New Living Translation says, now here is a genuine son of Israel, a man of complete integrity. When people see you, do they think integrity? What do they think when they see you? Because everybody has a thought about you when they see you. No guile, the Kingdom James Version says. Guile means sly or cunning intelligence. You know these people are always trying to get an angle? They're trying to come at you? What are they up to? What's going on in their head? Listen, I'm not the kind of person that has time to play games with you. Not you in here. Back home, okay, in Naples. Don't play games with people. Just be genuine. Listen, if you guys can get this, you are well on your way because you will then be a rare breed. Kingdom citizens are genuine. All we want to do is offer the kingdom if you want it. Only if you want it, right? That's a key. So that's my recommendation. Just be genuine. And along with this comes with having a pure heart. I love this heart. You can see right through it. Man, there's no black, ugly pieces of anything in that heart. God wants to be able to trust you. Can God trust you? Can God trust you with people? Can he trust you with resources? He's constantly testing you. So be mindful of this. Can you pass the test? Some people want to manage large churches or large corporations, but they can't even manage the 12 people in their organization. So be faithful to where you are now, and God's testing you. Then he will give you more resources. He'll give you more people. And God is honestly looking for people he can trust. When we did the Global Leadership Summit last year, Dr. Myles did in Freeport, you guys remember the theme was character? Who does a session, a whole seminar on character? I felt for the first time, I'm safe. I'm in an environment with a group of people that aren't after me for what I can give them. They're talking about character. So this is why I love my husband so much. Last year, I spoke on how we influence through the business realm through my hotel. This year, I'm going to boast on my husband because he's not here. He won't ever know. Don't let him know because he'll get upset. He already warned me. A few months ago, an attorney friend of his came to him and says, listen, you remember the BP oil spill that we had in the Gulf of Mexico in 2010? It devastated Naples. The hotel, dead. Nobody was coming to Florida because the food's contaminated. Do you guys remember that? Okay. People are still getting settlements for that. BP has shelled out billions of dollars in settlements. So the lawyers are still hounding people. Listen, we can get you money. And they call me at the hotel. We can get you more money. I said, I already got my settlement. I legitimately lost business because of the oil spill. I got a settlement. No, we'll get you more. And I say, don't call me anymore. Stop calling me and bothering me. I'm busy. I got my money, my legitimate settlement. Well, an attorney friend of my husband's came to him and said, you know what they're doing now? If you did a startup business in 2010, we can get you a settlement. And he says, okay, really? Well, that's good. And so he had his bookkeeper send the financials to the attorney. My husband came home a few nights later, And he says, Trista, I didn't tell you that we're getting a settlement because I started my architectural firm during the BP oil crisis. And I said, was that why you didn't do good the first year? Is that why we had a loss on our financials the first year because of the BP oil spill? He said, no. And I said, what makes you think that's your money? That's not your money. We can't take that. And I wanted to see his response. I wanted to see, yeah, but I was waiting. He says, you know what? You're right. That's not our money. And I said, we can't take that. And then he says, you're right. I'm going to email the attorney in the morning, and we won't take the money. So we emailed the attorney. The attorney replied and said, listen, I understand, but you would have gotten $460,000 in your settlement. Now listen, it would have been legal for us to take the money. It's our legal right, but is it ethical? Now, if I wasn't in the kingdom and I was religious, I'm like, the Lord's blessing me. My day has come. My check is in the mail. You know how many times we prayed that, right? The check's in the mail, right? I would have taken the money and ran like a bandit. But in the kingdom, I said, uh-oh, wait a second. I need to check this. Could this be a test? A $500,000 test. And we said no. And I was so grateful my husband is equally yoked with me in character. Because I know a lot of women whose men were to take the money and run. You know, sometimes us women are more sensitive to these things. Honey, I don't think that's the right idea. And the men do their thing. And I said, God, thank you for my man of character. I was never so proud to be married to him until that moment. Because he didn't fight me on it. I didn't have to convince him not to take the money. He knew. And that's one chapter in Dr. Myles' book about your conscience. You know. You know. And so I want to read two sentences from the email that my husband sent the attorney. He says, in good faith, I don't see how I could justify any of the income difference to be the fault of the oil spill. I was simply starting from scratch and was at the right place with the right talent, selling the right product at the right time, and I also had the backing of right standing, which I contribute to my success. Right standing. You see what word he used? And I go, and an attorney understands that. And I said, ooh, I love this government we're in. Now, if I was religious, I wouldn't understood what that meant. But even the world understands that. So he says, we have taken a family approach to live life to the highest possible standard, and gaining from something like this, when not internally justified, does not meet our vision. Does not meet our vision. Now listen, I forwarded that email to Dr. Myles, and I said, we passed a $500,000 test. How about that? He responded. He says, I'm proud of you. He said things like that. And then he says, I am so proud of that foundation you are laying for your son. He switched to generations. He switched to the next generation. So I said, wow, the decisions we make now affect our babies, our grandbabies, your future generations. Because of your right standing. And then he said something very interesting. He said, in the next 3 months, because of the decision your husband made, in the next 3 months, God is going to open big doors. Now, when I was religious, I was like, oh, the man of God's prophesying. Big doors, right? But I was like, he understands law. The law of success. He's prophesying, but anybody could have prophesied that. If you understand how law works and success works, it's natural. So we made a decision to be in right standing, to live with the highest possible standards. We will not take that money, even though we could. We had every right to. But in the kingdom, it's completely different. So I said, yeah, that's true. Of course God will open big doors. We are in right standing. Remember, that's our number one priority. Whatever you can do, remain in right standing. Every decision that you have to make, am I going to be in right standing with my government? Am I going to be living to the highest possible standard, living without people guessing my motives, wondering, how did they get that money? What's going on? You know, we see a lot of, like that show American Greed, all these Ponzi schemes and people, man, everyone's after your money. You can't trust nobody. So I'm going to show you a picture or something. I watched. Oh, here. Dr. Myles says, all shortcuts are evil. That stayed with me. That's a shortcut. If we would have taken the $460,000, that is all we would have. But because we said no, these big wig developers, you guys know how it works with fishing. You want to go after the big fish, right? Not get all these little tiny fish. So as an architect's dream is to get the big fish developer. Within 3 months, two big fish developers came to Matthew. He didn't have to wine and dine or bribe anybody. He didn't have to buy anybody a bottle of wine. He didn't have to bring anybody to dinner and schmooze them. Man, who's got time for that? Ain't nobody got time for that. So the developers came to him, and I said, wow, Matthew, because I was quietly waiting at home for the 3 months to go by to see what would happen. He'd come home and be like, what happened today? Anything happen? And the day he came home one day, Trista, the Ludkirds came after me. Everybody in Southwest Florida is looking for the Ludkirds. And I said, really? He says, Trista, they're building a development, 70,000 homes. I mean, these guys are big wigs. And I said, honey, how much will that equate to financially? He says, Trista, I have no idea, but at least 2 decades worth of work. Decades. He said, our son will be in college. And I said, man. So if we would have taken the 460, that's all we'd have. Character. Very important. Genuine, pure heart, no motives. Okay, point number 2, vision. Know what you want to accomplish. When we sit down with the mayor in Naples, we went to dinner with him, it was his wife's birthday a few months ago. We're sitting down. Trista, what are you up to? Well, everyone thinks I'm just doing hotel stuff. To me, that's boring. I've been running a hotel for 20 years. There's got to be more to life than that, right? But I can use it for the kingdom, which is what I'm doing. So I get to share with him, man, I'm developing a group of people. You should see what we're doing. And I get all excited. Whoa. So this will naturally bring influence when people meet you and they ask you. You don't go around promoting yourself. We didn't do that. And they say, wow, what's going on with you? Wow, that's interesting. Oh, I know somebody over here that's doing something like that, and you should meet them, and things start happening. Just like Nehemiah. He's sitting there solemn. He was sad on the job. And the king says, what's going on with you? Why are you disheartened? He says, my ancestors' walls are down. I want to build those walls. So then he gave him all the resources to make it happen. Everything you need to build this wall, the wood, the tar, the rocks, my quarry. The king provided for his vision, but he had a vision. So you need to know where you're going, because if you're flopping around going nowhere, you have nothing to show for your life, and then the people that are called to help you will never show up on the scene. So write your vision, make it clear, make it plain. When I meet Abraham, I know exactly what he's up to. He's in India doing water wells, helping the kids, developing leaders. I know what Abraham's about. What are you about? It makes you very narrow-minded. We're a very narrow-minded group of people over here from Naples. We have a vision, We have a focus and we stick to it. A lot of times we get distracted or we allow people to distract us. And I love what Nehemiah said. We call them professional distractors. And Nehemiah says, why should I come down to you? I'm busy. Who's going to build this wall? Listen, once you have a vision, you become a threat to the enemy, right? We're going to advance the kingdom of God here on earth now. And people are going to come across and distract you and get you to join their agenda. Why don't you come over here and do this with us? Because once people see you're going somewhere, then they'll come out of the woodwork. Then they'll want to join you or they'll want to use you for their projects. It would be like Nehemiah. Listen, I ain't got time for that. Ain't nobody got time for that. Just stick to your vision. And then God will bring the resources, the people that you need to fulfill it. Point number three, cultivate relationships. Now, this man here became a client of Matthew's a year ago. He's a very, very influential man. He was the CEO of Sony Records. He discovered Beyonce. He managed Pearl Jam, Aerosmith. He knows all the guys in Sony, okay? Now, Matthew, so he's retired now, but his wife was very sick with cancer. So they've kind of been held up, isolated for a while, dealing with this. So then they meet Matthew. They want Matthew to design a restaurant for them. And Matthew says, come on, let's go play some golf. And Matthew just became his friend. Matthew didn't say, oh, I want to meet Beyonce. How do I meet her? My wife wants to meet Beyonce. Listen, I don't want to meet Beyonce. She's talented and all, but I'm busy doing my vision, okay? So when we meet people, we don't want anything from them. We don't want their connections. We don't want their pocketbook. We just want to be their friend. Hey, let's go play some golf. So this guy had so much fun with Matthew on the golf course. He says, I want to join your golf course, your golf club, and play with you and your friends. I just have so much fun with you guys. Because he has no motives. You know, you see those people when they smell money and they come around you. You know? There came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who had himself become a disciple of Jesus. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body, and Pilate ordered that it be given unto him. Jesus discipled this wealthy man. This man had influence in the government, and when Jesus had a need, his needs were taken care of. But that's how it works. But Jesus didn't become his mentor because of how he could benefit from him. Like Dr. Myles was saying, you are a host, you feed people, you give them living water if they want it. So that's a very important concept. Cultivate relationships. All right, become a gift specialist. Hone your craft, not the craft of somebody around you that you think is your idea of success. When your gift is perfected, it becomes its own attraction. Dr. Myles. So there's value in specializing in your gift. And of course, the Bible says that your gift opens the way into the presence of great people. Not your education, not your doctorate, not your title. Thank you, Lord. I thank God for that because I got C's in school. I wasn't the brain child. So I thank God my purpose or what God has called me to do isn't tied to my education. It's tied to my gift. So specialize in your gift. David became a skilled slinger. That's what made him great. The women wrote songs about him, and he became the king because of his skill. He became on the scene. Who is this kid? Who is this little kid? He's from the fields. Who's this Trista from the trailer park? We thought we knew who she was. We didn't know her. So develop your skill when nobody's looking. Use your gift, use your business and resources to influence people. Ultimately, you will transform people, communities, and your nation. So I had to show off on my husband a little bit. He's created a niche. He's not just an architect. He now describes himself as the Florida architect. And he's created a design that all of these wealthy people that live in these big mansions in Naples with the Mediterranean look, they hate them now. They say, tear down my house. I want one of Matthew's houses. Because he created a very unique, cottagey Florida, but modern twist. It's very warm and not cold and big and empty. So everyone wants his gift. So I'm going to show off a little bit. Here's a beautiful Robin Stuckey building in downtown Naples. This is a 60,000 square foot furniture store. This was the first time this international store hired somebody that did not design just furniture stores. They hired somebody outside of the box. So this put Matthew's name on the block. And I want to talk about King David now. And I'm summarizing 1 Samuel 16. From that time, the Spirit of God came upon David, and he began to show signs of becoming great. And then what did he do? He got anointed by Samuel. And then he went back to the sheep. He developed his skill when nobody was looking. Now, when the man of God comes around and prays over you and prophesies, you're going to be great. You're going to be like Joel Osteen or whoever you think is great. You get all excited, right? You print your cards. You write. You go around promoting yourself. I'm Mr. So-and-so. But look what King David did. He went right back to what he was doing and developed his skill when nobody was looking. Who brings promotion? God brings promotion. Don't forget that. So stop self-promoting yourself. Man, people know what's up. All day long, David practiced throwing stones in a sling until he could strike exactly the place for which he aimed. When he swung his sling, he knew the stone would go to the very spot. He was very skilled. Now, this is dangerous. David was dangerous as a young man, but people didn't know. But he knew exactly what he was doing. We're going to get back to that in a minute. One thing I'm very mindful of, and I just wanted to throw this in, very mindful of my time. There isn't a lot of time for us here. Be mindful of this. Listen, I just went and saw somebody pass away in hospice last week. My mom passed away a few years ago. We just had, is it Mr. Cooper, Pastor Cooper? Just passed away last week in Freeport. 55, the one in hospice, I was 51. My mom was 55. Man, I became very aware of my time. It's limited. According to God, Ecclesiastes 3, he has made everything beautiful in its time. There is a time. Don't be premature. Don't do something out of time. Just develop your skill, chill, be genuine, hone your gift. And influence is natural. And God will bring promotion. You came out of eternity to complete an assignment in a certain period of time. Be very mindful. Every day I'm very mindful of this. Man's days are determined. And the men of Issachar, they knew the times and they knew what to do. They were a wise group of men. Understand what's going on around. That's why I love listening to Dr. Myles so much. He has a global awareness of what's going on the big scene of life. Number six, exposure. This is very important. God will never expose you to what you don't understand. I hear Dr. Myles talking all the time about government. He's influencing. I see these pictures of these people. And I said, man, I grew up in a Christian school. I went to Oral Roberts. I know nothing about politics because we were told to stay away. It's evil. So I grew up with that perception. I didn't vote. I didn't care. It didn't matter. I didn't know who's doing what because I was in the church praying, rolling around on the floor with everybody else. And then Dr. Munroe comes on the scene and just flips it all upside down. And I said, well, I got to get around this man because he's discipling the nations, something we talk about but nobody's doing. And I said, wow, I got to see how he does this. How is this possible? I've never seen anybody do this before. So I just kind of sneak around. Where are you going, Papa? Are you going on Caribbean somewhere? Are you going to the government's? I got to go see what's going on in here. We sit in that room. Whoa, it's on another level now. You guys, Dr. Myles has some skills. I have to boast, Papa. Skills. And I sit there like a little mouse in the corner. Wow. But you know what? I realize they really don't know a whole lot. He's teaching them vision. Oh, I read that book on vision. I've been teaching vision. I've been applying vision. I understand some things about vision. They don't understand. They don't have national vision. You're in government and don't have national vision? And I'm sitting there thinking, huh, this is interesting. You're leading a nation with no vision. We know where this is going. And here Dr. Munroe comes in. What's your national vision? They don't have one. And I'm like, wow. I heard Dr. Munroe one time say, if you only knew how ignorant they are, you're smarter than they are. Kingdom citizens, you have some answers that they need. I saw it firsthand. I said, these people really don't know what they're doing. They're guessing, right? They're doing politics. And I said, wow, so I wanted to be exposed to things I'd never seen before or never understood. Now I'm starting to get an understanding. I'm starting to wrap my head around this stuff. But I needed to be exposed to things I'd never had before. So invest in yourself. The more you do, God will trust you with people. Peter wouldn't go through a Samaritan town. He was prejudiced. But Paul, on the other hand, he was globally traveled. He grew up in a big cosmopolitan city, Tarsus. He understood international issues. He understood other cultures. He wasn't prejudiced. So God could use him. He wrote most of the New Testament. So get out of your little world and step into the world to see what's going on and start understanding. You guys are smart. I've heard Dr. Myles say that's the most important organ God gave you was your brain. We have to start using it and not just believing what the preachers say on TV, but read the books, start traveling, start finding a mentor in an area perhaps that you've been interested in. I mean, I remember when Dr. Myles, he went to Brazil recently, and he said last year when he went, there was this guy sitting there. Never been in politics before, but now he's running for governor this year. In 1 year. And I'm like, what an impact. Yeah. He goes into a nation, and then everyone wants to become politicians that are kingdom people. And I'm like, man, this is amazing. So we need to start being exposed to things we never understand. Then God can use you and trust you. But if you don't, you're limited. You limit yourself. Okay. Initiate. We heard Dr. Myles talking about that today. Leaders, do not wait. Break tradition. Don't be afraid to do things differently. Listen, if you get an idea, go for it. Do it. Growing up, this was my father's number one thing if he taught me anything. I'd be broken down on the side of the road. Or I'd be out in the river in the boat and the engines weren't working. And I'd call Dad. Dad, hey, I'm broken down. I'm stranded. You know what he'd tell me? Figure it out. Figure it out. My whole life, everything, figure it out. Trista, you have a brain. Figure it out. He never told me what to do, but he knew I could do it if I just figured it out. So my whole life, I've been figuring things out. I didn't know how to run a hotel. I was 21. It didn't matter to my dad if I was a girl or young. Just, Trista, figure it out. Okay. I figured it out. So use your brain. If you have an idea, go for it. Listen, what is stopping you guys? Honestly, what people say? Who cares what they say? There's one of my favorite scriptures I read when I was in college. It's from the Message translation. And Paul says, I'm not going to worry walking around eggshells worrying about what small-minded people think when I know what my large-minded master has told me. That stuck with me. And I said, it don't matter what anybody says. to me, about me, whatever. I know what my God called me to do, and that's what I will do. Because I know he created me to do it, whatever it is. Listen, it doesn't matter I'm a girl. My daddy didn't care as a girl. Did you see all the equipment? I run motor graders, front end loaders, drag lines, things you never even heard of. So it doesn't matter. Because whatever you were born to do, he created you to do it. That's real. We hear Dr. Myles say that. That's real. But for whatever reason, you've limited yourself in your mind from what other people have told you. And where are they going in life? Nowhere. And that's where they want you to go. Nowhere. But not kingdom people. Listen, I say this a lot. I say it's almost like we're cheating in life because we have the Holy Spirit. It's not even fair. We've got an advantage. You guys don't even know because you've limited your mind. It's all up in here. So whatever he tells you to do, just do it. Have initiative. Step out of the box. So don't be defined or conformed or confined by people's opinions. We started meetings in the hotel on Sundays four or five years ago. I started meetings. People would come in Sunday morning. I didn't have a musician or anything because I wasn't trying to build a church. We started out putting Dr. Myles' DVDs in. I'm like, listen, everybody, you got to learn what I'm learning. This is amazing stuff. Come to the hotel and let's learn together. We started watching DVDs, and then people started, Trista, we want to hear you speak, you know. And I'd be like, no, I don't want to speak every Sunday. Then I'll be like a pastor, and I'm not a pastor. I don't want to be a pastor. I'm a businesswoman. I want to run a hotel, and this is what I do. So over the years, something developed. And then I learned about ITWALA and this organization about training leaders and changing mindsets in third worlds. And I said, this is a very interesting concept. I was fascinated by it. I became on the board and a trustee, and then I started learning more and understanding more. And then I started thinking. And then I started getting ideas. And then I started looking at my resources. And I started looking at the people around me that were coming to Sunday mornings to learn about the kingdom. And then we started getting really serious this year. We were serious before. But then I started understanding some things. And so naturally evolved out of our Sunday meetings was a group of specialized people that had special skills, because I was having everybody bring me their purpose. Why are you here? If you're here, what are you going to do? What are we about? Let's do something. So everyone came in with a purpose, and all their purposes lined up to youth and training the youth. And I said, wow, look what's happening here. So right now, we're developing our skills in our community to empower the youth with their gifts, not mine, with their gifts and their skills and their uniqueness. We got a DJ on board. I mean, come on, a DJ. The youth need to hear a DJ, a kingdom DJ. I'm like, thank you, Lord. So something's evolving organically, and it's about a team effort. So I said, listen, let's stop Sundays. 2 months ago, I said, I'm done with Sundays. Praise God. Because not everybody that was coming because they really want to learn. They were coming on obligation. It's Sunday. That's what you do. So I was testing people's motives. Why are you here? I'm not going to entertain you. We're going somewhere. So I said, let's start meeting in the homes on different nights. We started doing different things. But now we're developing and refining. But I wasn't afraid to take the risk or break tradition. Hey, we're not meeting Sundays in the hotel anymore. And I gave them all graduation hats. We've trained you for 4 years. Now you go start doing something with this. Don't sit here and look at me and I have to spoon feed you every Sunday. Now you go, what are you going to do now? So that's what we're doing. But I wasn't afraid to break the tradition of Sundays. This is what you do. You go to church and I spoon feed you. So now the pressure is on them because they've been discipled. Now it's on them to go and disciple and to do something with us. And we're cultivating some things. We're just getting started. You haven't even heard anything yet. You just wait. Note to women. I had to put this up. Women may have a title, but you don't need one in order to lead. Look at all these amazing men on the panel. And you got one little woman, no title, from the trailer park. So ladies, break that glass ceiling. You don't need a title. That is not your identity. Now, I learned something. Ladies, you have something more potent than men. It's powerful. It's called influence. We're learning all about it, us ladies. So ladies, understand the power that you have. You don't need a title. You don't need a position. You don't need to look like a man or talk like a man. You just be yourself. Think kingdom. And you influence. Powerful. I won't go down that road. But it's a silent power. It's more subtle and more potent. All right, number 8. This one is so important to me. Collective potential. What did Jesus do when he was on earth for his ministry for 4 years? He chose his team. He didn't go around all by himself, saving the world all by himself. He chose a team, discipled them, and according to Acts, they turned the world upside down. I think about this all the time. What can I do as us collectively as a team? How can we impact nations as a team? It's called synergy. Synergy is an interaction of elements that when combined produce a total effect that is greater than the sum of the individual elements and contributions. In Greek, it means working together. Imagine the true ecclesia working together. What a concept. Imagine that. Not building our own empires. So when you hear about Trista, I want you to think that group of people in Naples, they're going to change the world and turn it upside down. In our way, in our unique way, according to our gifts. And it may not look like anything you've seen. It'll be different. I love how God uses the simple things to confound the wise. I love that. So keep calm and change the world. I don't know why my picture didn't show up, but I have a picture of the youth A-team. You guys remember the A-team from the 80s? And you had Mr. T, right? You had Hannibal. You had the crazy one. You had Face Man. They were all just a little crazy in them, just enough to make it work. You got a little crazy right here, just enough. They would go in, have their assignment, get the job done. But they did it as a team. But they didn't look like each other, right? Mr. T did not look like Face Man. Look at the diversity. We got diversity on this team. That's exciting to me. They don't look like me, but we all think kingdom. We all think the same. We have one vision. Imagine what God can do with a group of people that stay together long enough without fighting and I want to do this and I want to go do that. Life's too short for that. I'm very excited. I'm very excited to have a team of dedicated people for the kingdom. They said, this is it. The DJ came. He says, Trista, this is it. There ain't no other place to go. This is it. And I said, he's got it. This is it. The kingdom, this is it. What we're doing here, there's no place to go. That's what they said to the disciples said to Jesus. Where are we going to go? Everybody laughed. Where is there to go? There's no place to go. This is it, guys. Get the kingdom, impact it according to your unique gift. Take advantage of disadvantages. The world is supposed to miscalculate you. Goliath miscalculated little David. David had some skills. Trista from the trailer park has some skills that they don't know about. And I'm learning, always learning, always cultivating my gift. So Jesus made Nazareth famous. Remember they said, what good can come up from Nazareth? What good can come from Harvey Heights in Florida? That's the trailer park. What Goliath did not know about David was he was a skilled expert in slinging, right? Now, Goliath was an expert in hand-to-hand combat. Now, Goliath was a big man. He moved slow. He had heavy armor on. And little David came in, and you know what the Bible says? It says he ran to Goliath. He went whoop, 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 and he was done. Goliath didn't even see it coming. He miscalculated David. They are supposed to miscalculate you. They see Trista come in. Here she come. Here's just this little girl. Oh, she's been spoon-fed her whole life from a hotel. What could she know? They're supposed to miscalculate you. Jesus said, look like the dove, but think like the snake, the serpent. So you look. Girls, bat your lashes. Put your lipstick on. But you think kingdom. You are lethal. You are a lethal weapon. Number 10, I had to put a picture in here of me and my daddy. I told you I held a shovel when I was little. You see the trailer park? I found a picture of our trailer park. That's me and my daddy. What is the one thing you were born to do? Sometimes we complicate success. We have the wrong idea of what success is. But let me make it very simple for you. What is the one thing you were born to do? What is the one thing you should be known for? I'm known as the Hotel Kingdom Girl. So that I stay right with that. Stay with that. I just think business. I grew up in a business family. So it just comes natural to me. I don't know everything. I'm not Donald Trump's daughter or anything like that. She's very educated. But I'm simple. And I stay with that. I don't try to be like Ivanka Trump. Become focused on your passion. It would be very easy for me to look around at this distinguished panel and Dr. Myles and look at them and think, okay, what Peter Morgan is doing is successful for me, is my idea of success. I could say that about the LeMays. They have a big church in Virginia. Is that Virginia? Okay, North Carolina. I thought that came out wrong. Look what Dr. Myles is. He's speaking to 100,000 people. That must be success. But that's not success for me, for what God called me to do. He did not call me to do what somebody else is doing. So do not be confused of what you see people doing and you think that's success. Because that may be success for them, maybe. But that's not necessarily success for you. And people, I think, become confused. So the reason I travel with Dr. Myles, because I don't want to be like him. I have no desire to do what he does. It would kill me, literally. I know better. But I want to learn and glean because he thinks kingdom. I want to get the spirit of the kingdom. So don't try to be like Dr. Myles. Be like you. And focus on what God called you to do. And you will be successful naturally. It's a natural progression in life. It will not happen overnight. You will become successful when you focus on what you were born to do. Here's a quote from Dr. Myles. If you become successful in an area of life, you really become influential in the areas of life. So people in your community will start coming to you. The mayor calls Matthew during city council meetings, come down here and help us with this problem. He's an architect. You can be a banker. You can be a realtor. You can be, it doesn't matter your profession. If you're a kingdom person, they know you operate with ethics. You have no motives. But you just want the best for your community or for their organization, they will call upon you. You are diligent, developing your skill, honing your gift. They will call on you. They call on Matt, an architect, to solve a city's problem. Not twice, three times this year already. Because the mayor says, I can trust this man. You cannot influence without success. And without success, you cannot influence. It goes hand in hand. That's a quote from Dr. Myles. So I'm showing you a before picture of 29 years ago when I was a little lad. Here's the after picture. I put a picture of my dad. He still wears blue jeans. He still wears his baseball cap. He's just a good old boy who wants to drill water. He became the number one water well driller in the world because he can drill the deepest faster than anybody on the planet. But it took him 16 years to get to that point. It doesn't happen overnight. So let's read this scripture in Ecclesiastes. Now they lived in a city, a man poor, but wise. And he saved the city by his wisdom, but nobody remembered the poor man. So I said, Solomon said, wisdom is better than strength, but the poor man's wisdom is ignored and his words are no longer heeded. They didn't want to listen to him. He was still living in the trailer park. We got out of the trailer park. But it's a natural progression. If we're still living in it, nobody would think we're wise. You're in the trailer park. Yeah, it's a double wide, but still, you're in Harvey Heights. And I'm going to end with this, the domino effect. I want you to see how simple it can be. They say that if you have some dominoes, one domino can topple over the next one that's 50% bigger than it. So if you start out with your one domino, the next one's 50% bigger, and you continue down the line, by number 18 domino, you have the height of the Leaning Tower of Pisa. If you are at the 23rd, you have the Eiffel Tower. If you are at the 31st domino, the 31st domino looms 3,000 feet above Mount Everest. You see how dominoes just naturally fall? And it's a progression. Starts out slow. Now, the theory of this is it's a geometric progression. Is like a long, long train. It starts out slow, too slow to even notice, until it's moving too fast to stop. By domino 57, you're at the moon. So I encourage you, shoot for the moon. You can make it. If you believe you can. Man, my daddy made me believe I can do anything I want. Anything I think of, I can do. He never told me no. You just say, figure it out. So anything I want to do, I just figured it out. So in my mind, my potential is unlimited. But it's just according to how big I can think. That's been my number one problem, thinking big enough. The moon's pretty big, but by the 57th domino, you can attain it. Look at your resources. Look at the people God's put in your life. Look at your gift. Hone your gift, not my gift, not your husband's gift. And then have pure motives. And people will flock to you. People want to help you with the vision. God can trust you with the vision. He can trust you with finances if you can pass the test. Make sure you pass that test. Then God won't be ashamed of you. Remember? He says, study to show yourself approved so that he will not be ashamed of you. There's some people God can't use because they'll make him ashamed. Remember, we represent him. That's important. So be faithful. God ordained you. He's anointed you, but go back to the sheep and hone your skill. Thank you. Mm-hmm.